Hello everybody, this is Johns Hopkins with Baltimore Heritage, and we're back with another of our 5-Minute Histories videos, and today we're going to talk about the Baltimore General Dispensary. And I'd like to start by saying thank you to Meg Fielding, who did some wonderful research on early hospitals in Maryland and Baltimore, and Kay Dickerson for putting this information together. So before you tune out and say, well, I don't want to hear about Baltimore's medical marijuana dispensaries, or maybe tune in even more eagerly because of that, we are not going to talk about those. Those are way too new. We'll have to leave it up to future historians for that. We're going to talk about this organization that was founded in 1801, one of Baltimore's earliest medical providers. To give you some sense of that date, Hopkins Hospital was founded in 1889, Mercy was founded in 1874, and the University of Maryland Medical School, one of the oldest in the country, was founded in 1807, so even a few years later than our 1801 founding. Back then, Baltimore was not dominated by the big name hospitals that we know today, like Hopkins and Mercy and Maryland and Sinai. It was the landscape was more of dozens of smaller institutions and organizations, including dozens of dispensaries. Dispensaries were like outpatient clinics for the poor. There were some dispensaries that were general practice, some specialized in things like women and children. Some were associated with religious institutions. There was a Presbyterian dispensary and a Hebrew dispensary. There was even a homeopathic dispensary back then. But ours is not the oldest medical provider in the city. That title probably goes to the Baltimore County and Town Almshouse. It was founded in 1873, just west of the city. By 1820, it had moved to a former country estate called Calverton. And in 1860s, it moved clear across town to East Baltimore to where apparently you could see the Chesapeake Bay, because it was renamed Bayview Almshouse. And of course, we know that today as Bayview Hospital. Part of the Hopkins complex. Incidentally, the Calverton mansion that it had once occupied, when it left, some of Baltimore's Jewish leaders purchased it and turned it into an orphanage. It burned several years later, and they built a new orphanage, today's Baltimore Hebrew Orphan Asylum, that just got fantastically restored. Another early medical institution was a group called, let me get the name right, the Female Humane Associated School. And it was founded in the 1780s after the Revolutionary War to treat widows and orphans from that war. And it did really well. It also merged. It was like a magnet. It merged with lots of other organizations, the Female Orpheline Charity School, the Baltimore Female Orphan Asylum, the Home of the Friendless. And then finally, it moved out to the former estate of Enoch Pratt, the founder of our library system, and it moved out there to a mansion that the Able family, A.S. Able, hello bike riders, the A.S. Able family had donated, founder of the Baltimore Sun, and that was called Tivoli. It is on Woodbourne Avenue, and today it's known as just Woodbourne, so that's where it got its start. Incidentally, one of its stops was the Home of the Friendless on Druid Hill Avenue that became probably the first institution outside of private homes to offer health care to Baltimore's African-American community. So another pioneering effort there. All right, but back to our Baltimore General Dispensary. 1801, it was founded by a gentleman named James Crawford, Dr. Crawford. And Dr. Crawford also founded an institution, an organization that has to have the most interesting name of any in the state of Maryland. It was called the Maryland Society for Promoting Useful Information. And all that, although that might sound like something out of, Monty Python, it was a real institution, although I don't have a clue of what it did. We do know what the Baltimore General Dispensary did. It kept great notes. In 1801, its first year, it saw 234 patients. In 1807, it added a new service, Relief from Drowning. That sounds like a good service to add. In 1807, it also got a charter from the state of Maryland, making it the third oldest chartered institution in the state, behind only the Baltimore Equitable Fire Insurance Company and the Bank of Baltimore. In 1814, it had a report done on it. And let me read a few things from that report. You can sense maybe a little bit of bias here, but it's pretty neat. In 1814, so just as the War of 1812 was coming to Baltimore, the report says, "In every city of so high and opulent a class as the city of Baltimore, a dispensary is an essential institution." It goes on to say that this organization dispenses charity in a peculiar way. It gives present relief and prevents future calls on humanity. So preventative care way back then. And finally, it says that the dispensary was doing what it called holy work to administer to the relief of the sick and the afflicted, to the widow, the orphan, the stranger, and those who have none to help them. I think it sounds like it was living up to its motto of universal charity. So in the organization got its start with meetings at the old Indian Queen Hotel. That was where the former Mechanic Theater used to be. It moved around a little bit downtown. It for a while was on the 600 block of West Lexington in a row of houses that's now owned and used by the University of Maryland Medical Complex. So still in medical use there. And in 1911, it built the building here. That it got to provide not only outpatient service, but some inpatient service as well. Okay, I'm going to wrap up and say it operated all the way up into 1958, so had a really long run. But by then, apparently, other area hospitals were providing adequate care, and it stopped seeing patients. But this very old institution did not fold entirely. And to this day, it still provides funding for area hospitals and their outpatient clinic services. And with that, I'll say thanks so much, and we'll see you next time.